My name is Annette Brown. I'm Principal Economist here at FHI 360, and I'd like to welcome you to Research Roundtable. I'm here today with Kate Plourd and Patrick Olson, who are with our Global Health Population and Nutrition Program.
Thank you, Annette. Yep. We're glad to be here.
Thanks.
Great. So Kate and Patrick just published a paper in JMIR mHealth and UHealth titled Insights from a Text Messaging-Based Sexual and Reproductive Health Information Program in Tanzania, Retrospective Analysis. And we're going to talk about it today. So this is a really interesting piece of research. First of all, you're looking at an SMS-based program in Tanzania. So this was a program, still is a program, mm-hmm. to provide information to people about family planning and reproductive health through text messages. And what Kate and Patrick and their co-authors do is they actually take the cell phone data that were generated as part of the implementation, and they analyze these data to try to understand more about the program. And so they use these data, and these are a lot of data. This is over 3.5 million observations that they start with. And they use these data to calculate some standard indicators of user engagement, like new user, repeat user, activation, and conversion. And I found the use of those indicators also really interesting. So one of the things I really like about this research is just that you're using these secondary data, that these aren't data that you collected to do research. You said, how can we take data from the program and learn more? Another really interesting thing about this research is that you're looking at a program that's at scale in Tanzania, and you have 4 years of data about mm-hmm. this program. So a lot of your findings are interesting. One of the things that was interesting to me was just learning about the conversion rate, and that there were a lot of people who accessed your system but then didn't get all the way through to information. Mm-hmm. Although there were so many who started, there still was a large number who got information. And I also thought it was interesting which submenus of information they access. But I'll let you tell me a little bit more about that. So first, I just wanted to kind of figure out what you guys thought was interesting about the research. So Kate, what did you find sort of most interesting about doing this research?
Thanks, Annette. Sure. As you mentioned, it was really exciting for us to be able to do this retrospective analysis on this large data set. And one of the things that enabled us to do that was that this program was at scale in Tanzania. So we were in every district, and we had users across the country. And like you said, we looked at 4 years of data, but we've been implementing this program since 2009, so for about 10 years. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So that's a lot of data. So Patrick, what can you tell us that was interesting for you about trying to work with this many observations, this big a data set?
Yeah, definitely. It was a large data set, as you mentioned. We actually started out with just over 4 million cases.
Wow.
And then slowly whittled it down to 3 million cases that were actually usable. And when you're working with data this size, I think one interesting thing is just getting a better understanding of how the individuals interacted mm-hmm. with the M4H system. Mm-hmm. And after we sat down and after initial analysis, we realized that some of our indicators were inflated because of people were interacting with the system. For example, people would become very familiar with the menu patterns when accessing the system, mm-hmm. so they wouldn't have to start from the beginning. They could just go right to the menu that they wanted to.
Oh.
For example, if they wanted to know more information about family planning, they wouldn't have to start at the beginning. They could just go straight to the family planning menu.
Exactly. So it was very interesting for us because we had expected mm-hmm. the users to follow the specific pattern, more of a funnel pattern, to accessing the main menu and then going through and accessing unique messages. Mm-hmm. And then what we found was that our users were actually basically hacking the system and going straight to the message content because mm-hmm. they'd remembered, you know, the codes or they'd seen them elsewhere. So that taught us a lot about the way that users were interacting with the program. But it also showed us something about the way that we were analyzing the data, because we had set up the code in a certain way for the analysis. And then we had to go back and look at the data again to determine, you know, what the true number of unique users mm-hmm. was, for instance, or the true number of unique entries, because users weren't following the funnel pattern we'd expected.
Right. Very interesting. Very interesting. So you mentioned a little bit that they were hacking into the submenu that they wanted. Tell us a little bit more about what you learned about what submenus they were actually accessing.
Sure. Mm-hmm. So the majority of our users were most interested in the family planning messaging, mm-hmm. Which was not so surprising to us because we set up the messaging in phases. We started first with family planning messaging, and that was there for a few years, and then we expanded the content based on, you know, user interest that we were seeing for the program. So it's not unusual that there would be more family planning messages because they were there longer. But it was also interesting what we found in the years where we had the new content.
Yeah, even after we had introduced other menu options, family planning still remained one of the most popular options among all users.
So you had it right the first time.
I guess so.
That's good. So, but in the paper, you also talk about something that was a little more disappointing in terms of what happened with the submenus.
Sure. So we were a little bit disappointed by the use of the clinic locator database. Mm-hmm. And this was because it wasn't, you know, the most popular, but it actually took a large effort to set it up. So when we set up this program, it was 2009. There wasn't the same sort of mapping technology that we have today for digital applications, and particularly not with the global coverage. So we set up this clinic system manually by entering all of the various clinics and their locations and their phone numbers, and it was a lot of upkeep, and it was a lot of work. Work, exactly. And then there weren't, you know, a high number of users who were actually accessing that messaging.
Huh. Mm-hmm.
However, at the same time, I think one useful bit of information we got from the clinic data was that most of people accessing the clinic locator database were from urban settings. So it's something that we did get to take out of that.
Yeah, so that's a good takeaway. But as an economist, I always like to see that we're learning something about the cost effectiveness of our programming as well as the effectiveness. So I want to talk to you just, I want to wrap up to talk a little bit about the takeaways. So first, Patrick, what were your takeaways in terms of working with such a large data set? What would you do differently next time, or what would you be excited about working with data like this in the future?
I think what I would do differently next time is fully appreciate the scale of the data that we are being asked to analyze, and I would probably overestimate the amount of time I needed to properly clean the data set. But with that said, it was a really interesting data set to work with. You know, paying attention to all the different timestamps and realizing that that was an important factor when identifying people accessing the menus out of what we anticipated they would.
Great. And Kate, on the program side, what do you think the big takeaway is?
For us, you know, we learned a little bit about the importance of perhaps, you know, working with a data analyst from the beginning so that the data that's being generated by the program is compatible with potential research aims. And then we learned a little bit about user interaction. And so, when we first designed the program, we did user testing and we had focus group discussions and, you know, all of the things you should do before you establish a program.
Right.
And then we saw that as the program evolved, so did the participants' behavior and interactions with the system.
Right.
And I think that just sort of points to the need for continuous user-centered design throughout the implementation of, you know, a digital health program such as M4H.
Right. Great. Just so much that you learned with the secondary data analysis. Thank you so much for doing this research. And I want to thank you all for joining us at the Research Roundtable, and we look forward to inviting you to more Research Roundtables in the future. Thank you.